Right, the music and the title image are from Apocalypse Now. Great movie. I think that was made in 1979. I was all of 6 years old when that came out. Didn't see it till much later, and of course loved it. Its portrayal of the goings-ons in Vietnam was original, to say the least. I'm not exactly sure how accurate or if there was any realism or accuracy at all, perhaps a bit, but nonetheless very intriguing and interesting movie. And in the beginning of that movie, I don't know if all of you have seen it. If you haven't, pause this episode, go watch it and come back. But in the beginning of that movie, when Martin Sheen is in the hotel room going nuts and bloodies his hand, apparently that was all unscripted, and that was in fact a real injury that he sustained, and they wanted to stop filming, but he said no, keep rolling, and they did. So a little bit of trivia for you there. In fact, if you go to the Internet Movie Database entry for this film, you will find tons and tons and tons of tidbits and morsels regarding trivia in that respect. Also, as Martin Sheen did become the assassin, I think they at one time had asked Al Pacino to do it, and he said no, because you're going to be up there in a helicopter while I'm down here in the swamps. No thanks. Steve McQueen turned it down, saying I think something to the effect that it was too dark. Is that what he said? Yeah, something like that. And, of course, Harrison Ford gave it a shot initially, and then it ended up being Martin Sheen. So, that is Apocalypse Now, and of course the soundtrack is all of fantastic and haunting and eerie and surreal. It all just comes together quite nicely. So yeah, Apocalypse Now, and of course I thought that would be a fitting introduction for this particular episode, which will focus on Vietnam. Something I have neglected and yet to pay attention to, but no longer, because we will be tackling that subject soon enough. So, and I should also add that this will most likely be a hell of a long show based on show notes and everything I would like to cover. So, make sure you have some free time if you've just started this, because it's going to be a long one. All right. So the show shall be broken down into four parts. Just a heads up. The first part being the preamble, which is what we're doing right now. I'll get into some what's new with me, etc., etc., some news if there's any to be had. Then we'll get into Act 1, which is a little history of Vietnam. Act 2, which is games that deal with the subject. And finally, the epilogue, wherein I recap what has been said and project into episode number 50. I will say nothing more about that now until then. And some of you may know what that means, but yeah, more of that when we get to it. So, what is new with me? New with me is Vance Platoon Leader, of course, and coming along. That's about all I can say. I did manage to, actually had to take a short break from the thing, was slowly losing my mind. Every thought that went through my head dovetailed with the game in one form or another. How could I better do this? How could I? Should I change that? Should this be in there? What's missing? It's just constantly. It was incessant, and it was making me insane. So it was suggested that I take a small break, which I was reluctant to do, because you're so familiar with what you're doing, taking a break, coming back to it. You got to refamiliarize yourself with certain things, dig in, and get back where you were. But I also thought taking a break could have its benefit, because you return to the subject with fresh eyes. You may notice things that you were overlooking initially, and that's a good thing, to come back and have a fresh perspective on this thing and go from there. So what's left? What's left is obviously more playtesting for these historical scenarios, and right around the corner will be finalization of the rule book and getting that sent to the printers, and then having the scenario cards prettied up, have them sent to the printers, and finally the release. So the new official release date is in fact June 6th, 73 years to the day. Historically speaking, the subject matter that this game depicts occurred for real, so that I figured would be an exciting target date, and we'll have anything and everything ready to go by then, surely. And I apologize for the tentative release date, which was March. I think that was a little naive, a little too optimistic. And again, apologize for those of you that had your sights set on that date. But let me tell you, this thing would have been ready to go, but it wouldn't have been polished. It would have been rough. And I don't want to release it like that. We need to release it when the thing is polished in all its glory. And that's what we're going to do. So that's APL. What else? I'm watching a little hockey here and there. The St. Louis Blues, which is my dearest loving team, has been completely dismantled in a number of respects. Our general manager has just slowly ruined this team, to put it nicely, and one of our main goalies had a slight problem and basically sucked for a long time, and I'm not sure it's worth watching these days. This team went two games away last year from entering the Stanley Cup Final, to this year losing David Backes, losing Kevin Shattenkirk. So basically losing the heart of the team and losing a point generator, one of the top point generators on the team, and replacing them with the likes of people who are... they just don't cut the mustard, to put it nicely. So there's my little rant about the St. Louis Blues, and I guess being the St. Louis Blues, I guess you had to see it coming. I mean, we can't have too much of a good thing for too long. Again, this is a team that has never won a Stanley Cup, and I don't know. Someday, I guess, you know, there's times when I think, yeah, we may do it, and there's other times when I think, you know what, this team is cursed. We're never going to do it. So, again, there's my little rant on that. Of course, hockey being the only one of the few distractions I enjoy when I'm not at wargaming or at work or arguing / getting along with my significant other. So yeah, there's that. And then what have I been playing lately? You know, during my little break, I did set up. It was a hodgepodge of Commands and Colors Napoleonics mixed with Battles of Napoleon mixed with my own little homebrew. I played all of half a scenario and then took it down again. I've also been delving in. You ready for this? Hang on to your hats and keep this to yourselves. I have an image to uphold. A little bit of Dungeons and Dragons. Now, hear me out on this. I know this is way out of left field, but this is something that I messed with as a kid and then kind of off and on as the years went by, but I never really got into it and learned it the way it's supposed to be played. And I thought, you know, there's a number of people that play this nearby, and I thought maybe I could join one of their gaming groups and play along as well. I don't know if that will actually happen. And as it comes to... I've come to realize, I think I really just enjoy designing and building dungeons, which I have done, and quite happy with my first attempt. But, you know, again, this is yet another distraction, and since hockey isn't doing it for me, maybe this is my surrogate hockey, building dungeons, and that's that. So, yeah, I've been doing that, and waiting patiently for Old School Tactical Volume 2. I think we've got April release date on that. This was my first Kickstarter game that I backed, and being extremely pleased and surprised with volume one. I thought, you know, I'm gonna back volume two, and I think I did a pledge level where I basically get everything that was available for the Kickstarter. So that should be pretty cool when that shows up. Also have my first Dan Viersen game on order. Finally, yep, gave in. And this would be Warfighter World War II. Now, I really dig the mechanic, the system. However, I can't say that I'm a big fan of the aesthetic, the images that the guy chose for the cards. I thought was willy-nilly. He's got some color, some historical, some non-historical. I don't know. It confuses me. So what I may do, as I've noticed nobody's done this, assuming I will have time, which I won't, is eventually come up with a consistent historical deck of cards that I am content with using that match the wonder that is the game system. So there's that. Some stuff on pre-order still. The ASL Korea, which I think we've got anywhere from two, this is going to sound weird, but this is what I was told, 2 to 6 months still to go on that release, so that's still down the road a bit. And what else do I have? I have an Arnhem game of GMT release that I'm waiting on, and that might be it. So yeah, there's that. And noticed something, a couple of things actually. Let me start with a dash of Elan. If this means nothing to you, well, I'm going to explain it to you. A dash of Elan is this guy's YouTube channel, and I don't know that I've mentioned this in the past. I don't think I knew about it until recently, but give this guy a look-see. He's doing good things, especially if you're into Napoleonics. I don't know that this is all he does, but give the guy a look and see what you think. Also, when it comes to GMT games, looks like there is a Gandhi game that will be released. I believe this is the newest coin game. I applaud the originality of the subject. However, I can't say as I will get it, and I can't say as I have any desire to game the subject. Sorry. But, you know, I'm sure there are a lot of you that will and will love it, and maybe you can let us folks know what you think, but that's not some territory I will be treading anytime soon, if ever, so there's that. And then MMP proper, obviously waiting on the ASL Korea, but there are also some other pre-orders that have met their P500 or P whatever, just sitting. So I'm starting to wonder about MMP. Now, they did release, and I meant to do a video on this, may yet do it, the new ASL Journal and the Winter Offensive Bonus Pack. They did manage to get those out, bless them, and I'm very thankful for that. But as far as games proper, it's been quiet, and it's a little concerning. So not sure what's going on there. I guess patience will be the rule of the day, as always. And I think that pretty much covers it. Spring is right around the corner. I think winter is on the out. The days here in New Orleans have been just fantastic, beautiful. Not hot, breezy, cool, sunny. Just storybook days. Day after day, I think the last week has been picture perfect each day. So, good weather, and cat's doing fine. She's taking a nap currently. She's rather fussy these days. Not sure why. I think she's probably spoiled. Can you spoil a cat? I don't know. I think ours is spoiled. And if you haven't seen the YouTube, there's a number of them, YouTube video with cats and cucumbers. Now, I'm not sure what genetic predisposition is inherent within cats that makes them terrified of cucumbers. But it's real. These animals are just horrified of cucumbers. I only thing I can think of is there's something in their reptilian brain that as soon as they see this thing, they think snake or something. I don't know. Is it the color? Is it what? See, what you have to do is, when they're unsuspecting, perhaps eating, you place a cucumber, unbeknownst to them, next to them, and then when they turn and see it, they freak out. Now that sounds like cruel and unusual punishment, but if you do it once, consider it good for their blood pressure. You know, it gets their heart pumping. It's kind of like exercise. I haven't done this to my cat, but from what I've seen, it garners quite a reaction, and it's very curious. So yeah, there's that. Cat's fine. And I guess that brings us to the show proper. You ready to start the show? Let's start the show. What I've done here, and what I really wanted to do, was focus on specific American tactics in the field in Vietnam. But that seems to be scarce and hard to find. Either there is stuff hidden and I can't find it, or there isn't much to be said on the subject. Now, I find the latter hard to believe. And usually, in my attempt to look and locate this stuff, I've really only managed to pull out a more strategic overview in the U.S. military's approach to Vietnam. If you scope in to military tactics, again, I don't know if it's for lack of looking or what, but it's escaped me. So what I'm going to do is focus in more on a strategic approach, which isn't my first choice, but that's what we're going to do. And we're going to start with 64 and go through, I think, 67. We're not going to cover 68 or beyond for time purposes, but let us jump right in now. By the spring of 1964, less than 50% of Americans have even heard of Vietnam. So it seems interesting on the surface when you consider potential support for this conflict that will grow substantially. If you have half of the population that doesn't even know what Vietnam is, they haven't even heard of it, how are you going to drum up support for it? But no fear. The good old evil communism will never let you down. The 50s effectively planted the seeds of that stuff. Communism versus democracy, and of course, you know, you've got the whole Cold War thing going on with Russia after immediately after and almost during the end of World War II. But the 50s really did plant the seeds of communism as our next enemy. So that would serve a worthy purpose in order to drum up support for Vietnam. 1954, you've got a political treaty that divides Vietnam between the North and the South. And in 1964, you've got about 16,000 U.S. advisors that serve what they refer to as a training role to the South Vietnamese. They're going to train these guys to fight and let them do the dirty work. Kind of sounds familiar to our presence in Iraq, serving as an advisory and training role. Afghanistan as well, I guess, too, so that these people can fight for themselves. August 2nd, 1964 is when the fit hits the Shan, if you will. USS Maddox is attacked by three North Vietnamese torpedo boats in the Gulf of Tonkin. Now, that would effectively allow us to react. However, that isn't where it begins. Come to find out. My girlfriend's grandpa, in a kind of related subject, was in the Air Force, and in 63 and early 64 was involved in an air campaign to support Laos. Now, the North, the communists were attempting to take over and move through Laos, and it was important that the U.S. try to stop this because there's a main road in Laos that led to South Vietnam. But if my memory serves me correctly, so what happened is this guy, yeah, her grandfather was stationed in the Philippines for a while, but was flying out of an air base in Thailand where he was flying these missions and doing part of a bombing campaign against Laos. And he was flying unmarked airplanes. They didn't have the U.S. insignia, and for some reason or other was dressed in black, so not your typical Air Force uniform. Doesn't take much to piece together the fact that what's going on is the CIA is running covert missions long before this Gulf of Tonkin incident. And now don't get me wrong, I'm not stating that this Gulf of Tonkin incident is is the result of this air campaign. I'm just saying this stuff started before this, and in fact, the North Vietnamese have been fighting for 10 years prior to our official intervention. But that's an interesting little side bit, and not a lot of people are aware that yeah, the CIA was conducting air campaign against Laos, against the communists in Laos, and moving through Laos. But yeah, August 2nd, 1964, the ball really gets rolling with this attack on the USS Maddox. In fact, August 4th, 2 days later, a second attack is reported, and wasting no time, August 5th, 1964, U.S. planes do strike North Vietnamese coastal facilities. Now, on August 2nd, this would be 3 days after the second attack. Congress passes the Gulf of Tonkin Resolution, giving President Johnson freedom to do basically what he wants in Southeast Asia. So, Vietnamese or the RVN have already been fighting, like I said, for 10 years. And by the fall of 64, nearly one half of South Vietnam has been overrun by the Viet Cong. So they were moving en masse and moving quickly. November 1st, 1964, you've got the Viet Cong attacking one of four U.S. air bases, and this would be the first direct attack by the Viet Cong forces against the U.S. Jump to February 7th, 1965. The Viet Cong hit a second U.S. air base, and then you have what's called Operation Rolling Thunder, and some of you may be familiar with this, others not. This consists of a giant U.S. airstrike in North Vietnam, basically a bombing campaign that lasts 8 weeks, and the U.S. thought that by doing this, it would demonstrate a display of firepower so overwhelming that it would bring the North Vietnamese to its knees. And now, as these U.S. air bases, there are a number of U.S. air bases in Vietnam, I think at this point four, and they're all vulnerable to ground attacks. So, as such, yeah, it's decided that U.S. ground troops need to be brought in to defend these places, and this would be the first time U.S. ground troops are brought in for the specific purpose of fighting against North Vietnamese. Now, these aren't guys that are going to come in and train. These are guys that are going to fight themselves. U.S. pilots become, during this Rolling Thunder campaign, the U.S. pilots become frustrated because they're having to strike the same targets over and over. Why is that? Because you've got the North Vietnamese, they're getting hit. And almost as soon as the a specific area is bombed, they start rebuilding that area. So these pilots have to go back two and three times to the same areas to hit it, and that has an effect on morale, having to bomb the same thing over and over. You feel like you're spinning your wheels, you feel like you're getting nowhere. And what this does is bring to the American forces a realization that this isn't going to be a quick, fast war, that we're not going to scare the hell out of these people and they just fall to their knees as it's hoped. This is going to be a long, drawn out thing And I don't know that anybody wants that. So March 30th, 1965, in Saigon, the Viet Cong set off a car bomb outside the U.S. Embassy, and this is a big deal as well. This also is a foreshadow of the way of the type of enemy that we are fighting, almost borderlining on terrorists. These are guerrilla forces that are hitting and pulling out fast. They're not sticking around, fighting en masse. It's hit here, hit there, pull out, not sticking around again, and fighting a long drawn out battle anywhere. And losing momentum, the U.S. considers a new strategy to actively seek out the enemy and drive them out of the South. So by July 28th, 1965, Mr. President Johnson again, at the behest of General Westmoreland, upscales U.S. forces from 75,000 to 125,000, and there's going to be more to come. He also raises the monthly draft from 17,000 to 35,000. And by the fall of 65, 150,000 U.S. soldiers are in Vietnam. Now, before we get into the first major conflict, I should add that the 1st Cavalry Air Mobile was a relatively new unit within the U.S. Armed Forces. You've got UH-1 Hueys, which will utilize something new during this conflict, and that is a helicopter insertion of forces. These helicopters allow, obviously, the U.S. forces to utilize a direct approach when it comes to where they want to fight. They can land relatively close to an area. The U.S. forces can infiltrate and, in relatively quick amount of time, be in there and attack. Now, the first official U.S. ground offensive is about to take place, and this is going to be in Yadrang Valley. And there's a problem right off the bat. They want to do the helicopter insertion, and they come up with a landing zone that they like. However, this is landing on, and this is landing zone X-ray, as it has come to be known. And the problem is, the specific landing zone isn't large enough for all the choppers to land at once, unload the forces, and let them roll through and get out of there. And I guess there was no better landing zone to use based on the geographic area. But they go ahead and use this. However, they can only land about 8 helicopters at a time. So there's like a small funnel effect instead of an initial overwhelming effect. And this really allows the Viet Cong to effectively defend as this is going on, instead of just hitting them with a mass of troops. And this is going to take several hours. And there's an artillery barrage that precedes this. If I could back up, this takes place for a number of hours, attempting to clear the landing zone and the immediate surrounding area. They have to time this thing just right, because if the helicopters insert too early, then they're going to get come under their own fire. So, also right before this battle kicks off, they capture a Viet Cong prisoner. And interestingly enough, this guy's got some things to say. And make a long story short, he says that there are in fact 3 battalions awaiting this Air Mobile 1st Cavalry unit, which is not good. And they're basically chomping at the bit to kill U.S. soldiers. So what does that mean? That means the U.S. are going to be effectively outnumbered 8-1. If you've seen the movie We Were Soldiers, and I have seen that, I can't say I'm the biggest fan. I appreciate it for what it is. I don't care much for Mel Gibson. Not sure I care for the way the movie was shot. Anyway, this is what we're talking about. Yadrang Valley with this conflict. That's what the movie's depicting. And with once the U.S. forces are finally on the ground and they've been fighting all day, you've got night comes along, and what the Viet Cong do, very smart actually, is they spend all night here and there probing the lines to determine the weak parts and where they should attack on the next day. So U.S. forces get little to no sleep. They're getting attacked here and there throughout the night. Day two, the Viet Cong hit C Company's 1st and 2nd platoons. Then they hit Delta Company, having determined that these were weak links. And things aren't looking good. In fact, things are looking pretty grim. U.S. forces are holding out. You have accounts of particular individuals taking heroic stances. Got a gentleman on a machine gun. Basically, single-handedly allowing his platoon to survive, popping off machine gun rounds as he's wounded. Individual stories of heroism like that going on all over the place. And again, things are looking pretty bad, and it doesn't look like the U.S. forces are going to be able to hold out too much longer. So they resort to what is called broken arrow. And broken arrow is a code word that basically is a request for an airstrike. Now, it's not just any typical airstrike. This is an airstrike that will incorporate every and any available aircraft in Vietnam. If they're on a mission, they are to divert from that mission and drop whatever payload they have on the area that is called out for help, which is what we have in Yadrang. And it's really only this measure that allows the U.S. to regain the momentum and eventually save the day. But you have, again, some horrific accounts of planes dropping napalm on their own guys, and I won't go into detail about that, but as you can imagine, it isn't pretty. And there are statements that you can read about detailing the effects of napalm on people, and it's not good, as you can imagine. Day three, overall, Broken Arrow succeeds in pushing the enemy back. And you have first major U.S. victory in Vietnam. Now, what were they? They were outnumbered, what, 8-1, right? The final kill ratio, does anybody care to take a guess, was 12-1 in favor of the U.S. Can you believe that? Now, granted, I think a lot of this had to do with Operation Broken Arrow. However, that's pretty impressive. And the U.S. decides at this point that not only is this looking like a different type of conflict, the way to gauge success during this conflict will also be approached from a different angle. This is not a conflict that will be the success of which will be determined by the the taking of ground or territory. No, the success of this conflict will be determined by the number of enemy killed. And that is may sound somewhat odd, but that's how they determine they will gauge this the success of this conflict. 1966, you have something called search and destroy. This is again a somewhat new strategic approach to dealing with the Viet Cong. Again, you have troops that are going to actively seek out and stamp out, when they find them, Viet Cong, wherever they find them. And it's quite a task, quite a daunting task. So then you have troops dealing with mines as they're doing this search and destroy strategy, moving through, dealing with mines, booby traps, tunnels. And again, there's all kinds of books and documentaries about this. Particularly interesting, and I remember a book in high school, and I might do a little side note here and come back, but remember reading a book, I think it was actually called Tunnel Rats, and having seen the movie Platoon, I became fascinated with this concept of having to fight an enemy that is burrowed into the ground. I mean, how surreal is that? Well, this is in fact what you're dealing with. Bunkers, mines, booby traps, tunnels. Also, you have an enemy that is hiding in plain sight. that's just how it is. When you go to a village, you don't know if a number of the villagers there were fighting you the day before or the night before and returning to the village to be with their families. You just never know. But again, to go back to that side note, was a big Vietnam fanatic as far as the history of it when I was younger, especially during high school, as I said. Read books and books and books about it, and specifically was interested in the tunnel rats. Had a number of games dealing with the subject that I quite enjoyed. In fact, when I wasn't fighting pitched battles with friends in the woods, was building forts and such. And I don't know if I related this story to you. If I did, apologize. You know, I always wonder how people that write books can do so book after book after book without repeating themselves, because I can't even do 49 shows without repeating myself. But anyway, I had set up in the woods, farmer's field there. Now there were gullies and a brushy area that were along the perimeter of these fields. I had drug pallets out there that I placed in the creek so I could walk in these ravines that were almost like huge trenches. Had dug a tunnel into the side, one of the side banks of these ravines. I had ammo crates out there with dummy grenades and just anything and everything you would need. I had strung barbed wire up, was having campfires out there, just having a good old time. And one day, I didn't think anything of it, but I noticed a telephone worker out there, way out in a thicket, doing whatever it is that a telephone worker would do on the telephone pole. And then a day or two later, I wasn't at home, but I hear about this from my parents, that the police had come to the front door and were knocking, and they answer. And they want to know if they have any knowledge of or are familiar with what's going on in the woods. And what's going on in the woods, they ask. And, well, it appears that an escaped an army enlisted man has gone AWOL and is living in the woods. That is the assumption they have come to, right? They found all this stuff. They've confiscated it. And I can't remember if I think they did. They probably just told them, oh, that's our son. He plays army out there. But if that gives you any account of the scope to which I had things set up out there, yeah, they thought it was some dude that was living in the woods that had army training and was just hanging out there. So that was that. But yeah, big fan of Vietnam and anything and everything I could get my hands on, would read, watch, game. And this was also during a time in which I would hit up the recruiting stations. I was 16, 17, asking for posters, hitting the Marine Corps, asking for bumper stickers. And as soon as I was 18, they said, come back when you're 18, sign up. I said, yeah, I will, don't worry. Can't get here fast enough. Want to go in the military. I spend most of my days and evenings doing something military related, so I might as well, I don't know, get recognized and paid for doing it for real. And then comes movies like Apocalypse Now, specifically Platoon, that really made me think, and Born on the 4th of July. Now, I saw these movies and I thought, Jesus Christ, and here is where you can judge me, and that's fine. Judge away. Call me a coward, what have you. I will admit, yeah, I'm a coward. My perspective changed, and I thought, Jesus, Lord, do I want to go fight somewhere, potentially, and come back with, if not dead, in a box with one arm, one leg, etc. And I thought, this stuff isn't just about glory and heroism, Audie Murphy running around like a madman, firing left and right. like you do in the woods with your friends. Now, this was something else, and the reality of it, again, I understand these are movies. They're only potentially so accurate. However, it had an effect on my young mind, and I thought, you know, maybe going into the military is something that I should think a little bit more about. And lo and behold, didn't go. Ended up going to college, and my life went a different direction. However, that is, I wonder sometimes what my life would be like had I joined the military. But I didn't, so I'll never know. And that is my side note. And again, feel free to judge me as a coward for not joining the military. For those of you that did join, that are active duty, I have the utmost respect for you, and I commend you, and I thank you, and I appreciate your courage in doing so. Because, yeah, I don't know that I was courageous enough to make that step myself. So that's that. Anyway, where are we at with the history? That brings us to the US at this point in 1966 decides if we're going to do this thing and do it right, we need more boots on the ground to tackle this. So in May, we've got what, 280,000 troops in Vietnam. In July, that becomes 300,000. And by September, that's ups to 325,000. Until January of 67, you're looking at 389,000 troops in Vietnam. And here's a stat that may surprise you. A third of those are volunteers. A third of them, one in three soldiers in Vietnam have volunteered for this, which reminds me of the movie Platoon and Taylor, and when he admits that he volunteered. He was in college, I think going to med school, and decided he would volunteer for Vietnam. That those that were drafted proceeded to tell him or ask him if he was crazy. And I guess you gotta kind of have to be. Let's see. Then you get to the Tainan province, just again a particular area of Vietnam that was hot. And for example, if you were in this area, basically anywhere in Vietnam, you're gonna deal with 100 degree or more summer days with a 100+% humidity. So imagine humping through the elephant grass, chopping through it, bamboo, chopping through that. It's hot. You're carrying your crap. You're tired. Whatever. You're sick. Crapping your guts out. Dehydrated. What have you. Dealing with this now. Additionally, you have to worry about all the fun stuff that comes with the area. The animals that are indigenous to the area. Your poisonous animals, snakes, spiders, whatever. And constantly under threat of ambush and booby traps. Again, this is not an enemy that is going to that you're going to run to en masse, and they're going to stick around and fight a long, drawn-out pitched battle. They're going to run at you, hit you, and just as soon as they showed up and you're hunkered down firing, they're gone. Very rarely did they stick around. Then you have, Viet Cong that are hard to pin down and fight. You've got scouts that are alerting troops, U.S. They're alerting their own troops to approaching U.S. troops. So if you get to a particular area where a Viet Cong presence has been suspected, by the time you get there, they're long gone. Where are they gone? Who knows? You got to continue to search for them. And you're getting to these villages where you find time and time again traces of the Viet Cong. Now, I understand there's something called My Lai and the horrible massacre that went on there. But as horrible as that was, I can also understand, and I don't condone it, but I can also understand the frustration of U.S. soldiers who are getting hit, suffering from hit-and-run attacks. They're seeing their buddies get wounded and flown out. They're seeing their buddies get killed. And this is going on and on and on, and very rarely are they able to vent this frustration through battle. Booby traps are taking people out. It's almost like you're fighting a ghost. And when you do get to a village that has the people in it, what are you going to do? Especially when you find that they're stashing food and troops for Viet Cong. Again, you don't know if any of these villagers are in fact Viet Cong. What do you do? I don't know what you do. But again, when you have atrocities that take place, I think it is a result of this mental fatigue and stress that you're dealing with day in and day out. And that stuff comes out in an ugly form. And that's what you're dealing with there. And also, you always see the choppers flying troops in, and most people associate these Hueys with that. But you have to remember, you have to picture that just as many troops are being flown out as in, and then these are troops that are, again, wounded, dead, dying. when a chopper comes in to pick somebody up, it takes, on average, an hour to get to the nearest medevac hospital, if you will. A lot of guys die before they get there. It's just grim stuff. And another thing I should add, and I'll go back to the movie Platoon, where you see in particular them going out one night to put up an ambush post and wait for the Viet Cong to run into them, and then they come back and smoke a bunch of pot and get drunk and have fights and bitch about Vietnam. That is completely inaccurate. What you have going on is troops humping through the jungle for anywhere as long as 30 to 40 freaking days. This isn't a day and come home and chill, or just go out for an evening and have a little firefight and come back and relax. This stuff is going on for 30 to 40 days at a time. Can you imagine going through the jungle, dealing with that crap for that long of a period of time? No thanks. So definitely not like the movies where you hump one day and come back and enjoy yourself. During the first 9 months of 1967, you've got 6,900 Americans killed. And that is more than the total that had been killed in the previous 5 years combined. So the stuff is escalating at a rapid rate. At this time, you also have the U.S. sending in excess of $500 million in aid to South Vietnam. Now, why is this important? Because it is, in theory, supposed to be helping the South Vietnamese deal with the North Vietnamese, but that also becomes key because at a certain point when Nixon is in office, especially once Watergate hits, this aid is going to stop coming. And that's going to affect the South Vietnamese ability to effectively deal with things, as can be imagined. And again, more of the same. North Vietnamese refused to engage in direct mass conflict, choosing instead guerrilla tactics, hit and run. Which brings us to October of 67. You have another conflict gearing up. And this is the Doc To. You've got 6,000 North Vietnamese massing near a U.S. base at, again, what is known as Doc To. And by November 3rd of the same year, it's decided that there's going to be a major B-52 strike to help take care of this. And then the ground troops, the U.S. ground troops, are going to move in and mop up. And what this turns into is the largest attack since Ya Drang. So after 3 weeks, the U.S. stopped the NVA, but only a small number are killed. What happens to the rest of them? Well, they withdraw beyond the Laos-Cambodia border, and they would do this quite regularly. You should be reminded that U.S. ground troops are not allowed to cross the Laos-Cambodia border for various reasons. So you have the Viet Cong and the NVA crossing the border, hitting, and then going back across the border. Now, we could conduct airstrikes there, but those are only so effective, especially with an enemy that is so burrowed into the ground and bunkers and things, rarely does that have anything more than a psychological effect. But the bulk of these troops that escape, that are withdrawing, they go to what is known as Hill 875, and this will become famous. This is not what will become known as Hamburger Hill. That came later in 69, I believe. But this is another hill, famous hill. And the U.S. decided to give chase in an attempt to cut them off at Hill 875. Now, they pinned down a number of NVA sizable force here, and they attempt to take the hill, which sounds a little bit odd because it seemed like body count is how we were going to determine the success of this battle. But now it seems like, no, we need to take this hill. And I understand the NVA are hunkered down in this hill, so there's that. But what's going on is, or what has gone on is, the NVA have basically transformed this hill into a fortress. They've got bunkers, they've got tunnels, they got everything. And this hill is hit repeatedly with artillery and the like, until it looks like just it doesn't resemble anything that you would associate with a hill. It's just a burnt, scorched landscape with stumps and broken trunks. And I should also add that this is interesting. During World War II, right, an infantryman averaged 10 days of combat in 1 year while they were there, while in opposition to Vietnam, where an infantryman averaged 240 days of combat in 1 year. Tell me that doesn't take a toll on you. Of course it does. So here the NVA are on Hill 875. They've transformed this thing into a fortress, and you've got U.S. troops attempting to take the hill. By day three, choppers try to resupply the U.S. troops on the hill, but they're getting shot down. Two of them get shot down, and they decide, well, maybe this isn't the best time to resupply. And what it reminds me of, really, especially at this point, because the U.S. decide, okay, it's time to familiarize yourself with flamethrowers, and we're going to move in and start using that. It sounds a little bit like the Germans in Stalingrad trying to weed out the Russians. Now, granted, this isn't an urban environment, but you got a similar occurrence taking place. And finally, by day five, they take the hill. Now, December 1967, you've got 16,250 U.S. killed in Nam, and by the Tet Offensive of 68, a half a million troops are stationed, deployed in Vietnam. And that is where we will stop with the history, and would love to do more, but again, time's sake, that leaves out, of course, again, the Tet Offensive of 68, major, major, major battle. Touched briefly on the massacre at My Lee. And also won't be touching on Hamburger Hill, which, yeah, did in fact occur in 1969. And there is a movie that depicts that. Again, how accurate is it? Who knows? Probably not at all. But if you want to watch it, it's there to be watched. And that effectively ends our historical overview of at least the up through 67 in Vietnam. And take a break here and cut to some games that deal with it. What games are out there? What games do people seem to prefer over others, etc.? And yeah, so I'll see you on the flippity flip. Thank you. All right, welcome back. And what I will do is go in reverse order from best to worst. What does that mean? That means I'm at Board Game Geek looking at the war game ranks. And when you do that, in the 14th spot is something called Fire in the Lake. This came out in 2014. And I haven't played this, but I did purchase this. Now, why would I purchase this and not play this? Because I purchased this as a gift from my brother, hoping again to breach that barrier into board games. Now, he started off with board games, and he's heavy enough into computer games, but I thought maybe this is the gateway game that will draw him back into the war board game universe. But I don't even know that he's read the rules. Now, the only thing he did say is when the box arrived, "Hey, I just got home and there is a huge box on my doorstep." And I imagine it's pretty big. This thing is has a lot going on. So Fire in a Lake, designed by Mark Herman and Volko Runke, who Volko should ring a bell. Well, both should ring a bell, but Volko, of course, the designer of the coin series. Am I right? Am I wrong? I believe. And Mark Herman, longtime board game designer, with artists Roger B. McGowan, Mark Simonich, and another gentleman whose name I won't attempt to butcher. What is this thing? This is, in fact, volume 4 in GMT's coin series, dives headlong into the momentous and complex battle for South Vietnam. A unique multi-faction treatment of the Vietnam War, Fire in the Lake, will take 1 to 4. That's right, you can play this solitaire. Players on U.S. hellebore sweeps the jungle and communist infiltration of the South and into inter-allied conferences, Saigon politics, interdiction of the Ho Chi Minh Trail, air defense of northern infrastructure, graduated escalation, and media war. Renowned designer and modern warfare expert Mark Herman joins Coin Series creator, Volko Runke, for a collaborative production not to be missed. Fire in the Lake features the same card-assisted counterinsurgency game system as GMT's Andean Abyss, Cuba Libre, and A Distant Plain, with a pack of twists that take the series to another level, including pivotal events that trump initiatives, such as the Tet Offensive, Vietnamization, which would be Nixon's policy, Easter Offensive, and Linebacker 2, enter coup campaign effects that vary by Arvin leader, counterinsurgent guerrillas, specifically U.S.-led irregulars and Arvin Rangers, insurgent troops, NVA, for direct force-on-force engagements, tunneled, now how about that, tunneled VC and NVA bases, trail construction and degradation, a larger-than-ever event deck for even greater play variety, short and medium-length scenarios with either random or period event options. What are you going to get in this thing? You're going to get one 22-inch by 34-inch map, 248 wooden pieces. Now, not a lot going on with these wooden pieces. They're not there to look pretty. They're there to serve a function, and then that's what they do. And we are also looking at 130 playing cards, one full color counter sheet, rules booklet, a play booklet, 9 player aid sheets, 3 six-sided dice. And this was also the 2014 Golden Geek Best War Game winner. And the 2014 Golden Geek Best Solo Board Game nominee. According to the Board Game Geek stats, now this wouldn't be everybody that owns a copy, but everybody that's on the Geek comes to over 3,000 people own this game. And it looks like over 1,000 wish they had it. Well, go buy it. Looks like there's a first edition copy for sale on the Geek, going for $65. Not a bad price for a good giant game. And if you go to the Board Game Geek entry for this, there are over almost 200 images you can take a look at. So what I may do is, and I hate to be an Indian giver, but maybe ask my brother if he could at least lend me this game. Let me take a look at it. So that's Fire in the Lake. The top Vietnam game, according to you board game geekers. What's the next one? That would be, this might be a little surprising, but that would be Hearts and Minds, Vietnam 1965 to 1975, came out in 2010, Worthington Games, designed by John Poniski, artist Sean Cook. I'm not overly familiar with this. I don't own any Worthington Games. Been interested in Band of Brothers for a while, but yet to pull the trigger on that either. Perhaps what they're best known for. But Hearts and Minds, this would be a card-driven game covering the American buildup of troops and arms in Southeast Asia as to our decision to begin troop withdrawal in between 65 and 75. Game is quick, 3 to 6 hours, and clean. Map uses area movement and uses most major events of the period, including proposed events such as the McNamara Line, which was never actually built. Although nominally a combat game, the mechanisms actually revolve around both sides occupying South Vietnamese provinces for propaganda purposes. The heart of the game is political influence. There is little doubt that the Allied player will eventually withdraw his American boys from the quagmire, but the question is how quickly and in what numbers. Now, this thing contains 80 cards, tokens to represent forces, turn tokens, withdrawal tokens, reduced movement tokens, as well as close air support. Communist air suppression and artillery are also included. More rules cover air cav, naval support, riverine interdiction, and bombers. Untried troops are a liability in the game. Veteran troops are a necessity. Ultimately, the communist player must deal the Americans such a crushing public relations disaster that he will abandon his Southeast Asian allies before the momentum of those allies stalemates the irreversible infiltration of South Vietnam. And this was a 2010 Charles S. Roberts Best Post-World War II Era Board War Game nominee. Other than that, I don't know a lot about it. Now, again, looking at it, it seems to be a from a strategic angle. But that is Hearts and Minds, and according to y'all, that is the second most popular Vietnam-themed game. Which brings us to the third most popular Vietnam-themed game. Vietnam 1965 to 1975 came out in 84. I own this monster, this confusing, complicated, nightmarish beast. By Victory Games, an offshoot of Avalon Hill, everything, and I don't say this lightly, everything that Victory Games produced was fantastic. Designed by Nick Karp, and again, a strategic point of view. This is simulation, and really is a straight-up simulation that recreates one of the longest, most complex, and least understood conflict in U.S. history, and all of its military and political aspects. If this were to come out today, it would be a Fire in the Lake type design, I truly believe, but for its time, this was the Fire in the Lake of its time. So the rules include detailed treatment of movement, terrain, search and destroy operations, special operations, firepower, air mobile, riverines, brigade level formations, limited intelligence and auxiliary units in each scenario. The scenarios start out small, with Operation Starlight, and slowly build in complexity, introducing more rules until the entire campaign scenario, which covers the entire war from 65 to 75, and introduces South Vietnamese politics, morale and commitment, strategic bombing, reinforcements, and pacification. Unit counters are battalions and regiment size, and in 84, this won the Charles S. Roberts Best 20th Century Game. Also, the Charles S. Roberts Best Graphic Presentation in an Adventure Game. And it looks like just under 2,000 of us own it. Get a copy on The Geek for as little as $120, but you're going to pay a lot in shipping because that's coming from, where is that coming from? Poland. Probably find a copy of this on eBay or go to Noble Knight if you're interested. Now, I'm going to put a disclaimer up here. This is not the game I would recommend unless you are hard, super petrified hardcore into long, opaque, thick, complex games. If you're relatively new to wargaming, run screaming from this. If you've been gaming for a while, seriously consider what you're getting into. And if you're, again, a veteran grognard who just eats these things up like cereal, well, then this is for you. But this thing is no easy game to run. And it says two players, but you might be better off to grab three and four players to help run this thing. So that is Vietnam 65 to 75, the third most popular Vietnam-themed game. And again, another strategic perspective that we're dealing with. Let's go to, you may have already guessed it, but yep, Lock and Load, Forgotten Heroes Vietnam, came out in 2003, designed by Mr. Mark Walker, author, game designer, Rebel Rouser, extraordinaire. Looks like you've got three, four, five, seven different artists that worked on this thing, which seems a little odd to me, but whatever. What is Forgotten Heroes Vietnam? Well, I'll read you a description of it. Also, you can head over to Kev Sharp, his YouTube page. He has a number of videos posted about this. Also, of course, Marco Wargamer. And it looks like Callisto has a video posting regarding their take on this. And this is a second, what we're looking at here specifically is the second edition with new art. Which has been completely updated. Each counter has been redrawn. Every map created new, also new skill cards, scenarios, charts, and rules. This simulates combat in Vietnam, go figure, with squad-level combat. Okay, here we go, our first tactical approach, and it's a lock-and-load game. Counters represent squads, leaders, medic, chaplains, machine gun tanks, and more. Turns cover 30 seconds to 3 minutes, and the interactive impulse system keeps both players involved in the game. This is a Charles S. Roberts Award winner, International Gamers Awards Game of the Year, and voted by Game Magazine as one of the top five conflict simulations. What's in the box? Five maps of the Vietnamese countryside, 340 color counters, 16 skill cards, a rule book, a player's aid card, some dice, and a box. Looks like just under 1,000 of us own this, and if you want a copy of this, you can get one. Looks like for $39 on the Geek, or again, I'm sure there's a copy on eBay or through Lock and Load. So there's our first tactical entry into Vietnam. I haven't played this. I'm somewhat familiar with Lock and Load Tactical, having read the rules a number of times, just to familiarize myself with the goings-ons of Mark Walker's mind. But I would recommend this, especially if you want to come at it from a tactical angle. Definitely. So there's Forgotten Heroes, Lock and Load Forgotten Heroes Vietnam. Came out in 2003. And that would be number four, if I'm not mistaken, which brings us to number five. Number five, Silver Bayonet from GMT. Designed by Gene Billingsley, who, again, unless I'm mistaken, is also, I think, the owner or one of the owners of GMT. Is that right? Artist Charles Keebler. Name should ring a bell. I believe he's done some stuff for ASL as well. And this thing has just come out with the 25th anniversary edition or something to that effect. This recreates a pivotal November 65 battle between a full North Vietnamese Army division and the U.S. 1st Air Cav Division in the Ya Drang Valley. So that first battle I talked about in our history section, if you want to play that out, you need this. NVA expertise in lure and ambush tactics resulted in significant U.S. casualty. U.S. mobility and the ability to bring massive amounts of firepower to bear quickly virtually destroyed the attacking NVA division and forced a change in NVA tactics, and that would be referring to Broken Arrow. This is a reissue of the 1990 CSR award-winning title. That started it all, keeps original operational system, but streamlines it to include innovative combat resolution, integrating maneuver combat, close assault artillery, and support from gunships and air sorties, increased accessibility to primary and secondary source material, has made it possible to make changes to more accurately represent both sides' unique capabilities without significantly altering or breaking the base game system. The major changes involve patrols, ambushes, landing zones, and the 1st Cav Brigade headquarters, while minor changes tweak movement, combat, and coordination game mechanics to showcase radically different strengths and weaknesses the FWA and NVA force brought to the battles in the Yuedrang Valley. Looks like only 400 currently on this edition, and if you want a copy, I don't know if GMT still has it. They usually sell out unless you pre-order. Again, eBay. And this thing looks pretty legit. Yeah. If you want something not quite straight up tactical and not quite straight up strategic, this is what you want. Middle of the road. And go to the Geek, check it out. Looks pretty damn good. So that's Silver Bayonet, and that would be, I believe, number 5 in popularity for Vietnam games. And that brings us to a little magazine game. This thing is long out of print. If you can find it, more power to you. I highly recommend it. Week in Hell. And this is The Battle of Hue by Laurent. Sorry, Laurent, and I talked to you briefly back in the day about some stuff. Hello. But, Laurent, I'm going to mess your name up here. Gwenet? I'm sorry, Laurent. Battles Magazine, though, and that is a great magazine. In fact, Laurent has a new game coming out that looks awesome. And this isn't his only game either. Week in Hell is a solitaire war game at the platoon level, which retraces the fighting of 5 Marine companies for the liberation of downtown Hue from January 31st to February 6, 1968. And it simulates combat where the player controls Marines attempting to take control of almost the entire map and rendezvous with units entrenched at the northern edge of the map. Units begin the game off board, and the game is divided into 7 turns, which each has 10 phases. Wow. Each turn representing one day of fighting. A unit can either fight or move, and after it has defeated an enemy unit, it needs to stay one turn in the same spot to mop up. I like that. And this was a 2010 Charles S. Roberts magazine game winner. Looks like about 500 of us own this. 500 lucky souls. So I don't know if you could get this at Noble Knight, but man, if you could find it, definitely pick this up, because it's a small gem. All right, and that brings us to a game that has forced me to jump through the rankings. Now, I may have passed over other Vietnam games to get here, but short of spouting off a 5,000 long game list, the ones that I mentioned are worth looking into, but also 65, and this is again a Mark Walker game that just came out. It should jump up the rankings here before too long. 65, Squad Level Combat in the Jungles of Vietnam, and 2 to 3 players, Flying Pig Games, which is, Mark, for those of you that don't know, Mark founded Lock and Load and ended up selling it to David Heath, who has continued to carry the flag, Lock and Load flag, but now Mark is doing Flying Pig Games, which is what he released his Old School Tactical on, a fine and dandy game. So what is this? This is a squad-level tactical game which recounts the early battles of the Vietnam War from Yadrang to Operation Starlight, most everything in between. The large and beautiful counters represent squads, leaders, heroes, snipers, and tanks, plus much more. As these units commander, you will move and fight over three geomorphic game boards. Now see, I have a problem with that. You only get three boards with this unless you kickstarted it and get all the extra goodies. Yeah, you can these boards combine to form a giant board and all that, but you only get three boards, and as you try to best your opponent in one of eight nail-biting hysterical, that's funny, historical scenarios. The game is card-driven using a system similar to Flying Pig's Knight of Man, which met with quite a bit of success, and adds a sense of delicious uncertainty to the play. Can I advance my sappers, or does the enemy have a fire card he's just waiting to play? Furthermore, the cards simplify the game, containing much of the data needed to play. You won't spend the afternoon with your head in a rule book when you play 65. This is a game created for gamers, by gamers, for gamers to play. So says he. And number of views on this. Generally, people seem to like it. There are a few gripes and grievances here and there. Nothing major. So yeah, there's that as well. So there's some games for you to look into. Where is, as I peruse my game shelves, I would definitely stay away, unless you know ahead of time what you're getting into, stay away from Victory Games, Vietnam 65 to 75. That thing is, it's going to give you a migraine. That said, if you want something somewhat strategic, yet a little lighter, let me back up. Fire in the Lake, take a look at that. Now, if that's your first coin game, that may not be the best game for introducing you to the system. But if you have confidence in yourself, and I have confidence in you as well, you could probably be just fine making that your first coin game. Fire in the Lake is worth looking into. Silver Bayonet, also a little more scaled down in scope from Fire in the Lake. That is also worth looking into, and then Lock and Load, tactical Vietnam game, as well as 65, both worth looking into. A little bit quicker, fast play type approach, but also honorable mention, another game I have. There is a game that came out by Avalon Hill back in the day after the movie Platoon came out, called Platoon. Now, I don't know that you can solitaire this, but it is a fine, fun game, something you could actually take to the pub and bust out and get a couple games in a hurry. Beer and pretzels type thing. I had a blast playing this back in the day, and that's also worth looking into as well. So there's your games, and as they relate to Vietnam. If you guys are interested in Vietnam, again, I don't even know where to start, and the stuff is still spewing out books, documentaries, movies. If this is an area that you have yet to mine as far as gaming or just general interest, it is just rich in offering what it has to offer. you won't get bored anytime soon. And I've been meaning to do a Vietnam show for a while. So yeah, this was a long time coming, and lots of good stuff within the theme. What does that leave? That leaves, I wanted to add, I think Axis and Allies has been stale for a while now, and I'm not an Axis and Allies fanatic, but I did like the D-Day game they did, as well as the Battle of the Bulge game. And I've always thought they should do a Stalingrad game, but if they were to branch out of World War II, I think Vietnam would work well as an Axis and Allies game, especially as demonstrated by Fire in the Lake. It shows you could do kind of a area movement type thing. And Larry, if you're listening, right, maybe look into when you get after the Stalingrad game I want you to do. Well, let's release a Vietnam game, all right? And it's time. It's time for some new Axis and Allies stuff for those Axis and Allies fanatics of you out there. So yeah, that's it. And as far as the next show, what do I got going on? Well, that will be the fabled, long-awaited, never thought I would get here. Not that I was chomping at the bit to do it, but I never thought I had 49 shows in me. And some of you might say, well, you kind of didn't, because well, I'll be the first to admit, some of these shows aren't the best. There are definitely others early on that are much better, in my opinion. But sometimes it's hard to keep something going. It takes effort, it takes work, it takes time. And yeah, I'll admit some of these shows I probably didn't feel like doing or shouldn't have done, but did them just to keep going. Others I am particularly fond of and enjoy doing. But now we're at show 50, and that begs the question, as I've presented the potential possibility that this would be the final show. Now, I won't make that announcement just yet. I will say I am still leaning towards that being the final show, but again, won't announce anything official until episode 50, and rest assured, I will come up with something new, different, revealing, interesting, not sure what, but it's not going to be your run-of-the-mill show. You have my promise. So episode 50 will in fact have something different or new in store for you as we celebrate potentially the end of Hexes and Soldiers War Game Podcast. I know a lot of you, if this does become the, if this is in fact the end, will argue, well, you know, there's so much more out there to be covered, and I enjoy the show, and stop, don't stop doing it. I get all that, but there's something in me that says it's time to end it. And again, I'm not making an official announcement. I'm just riffing here, but I do have something, a little voice that says maybe it's time to end this. Do something different, do something new, or just stop, because I don't want to fade away and to just like, oh my God, that, yeah, that show, it's still going on, it's awful, it used to be good. I don't want that. I want to go out with a bang. And so yeah, nothing official yet, but episode 50 right around the corner, and who knows when that'll be. Could be a while, because as we get to near the finish line for Advanced Platoon Leader, there are a lot of things that still need to be done, and that will again take up most of my time. And I guess I could say that I may have an announcement regarding H&S Games and all things Platoon Leader, etc., once that's released. So that's your show, episode 49, and I've been Jason. And you know, I should add, I always appreciate you guys listening. It really means a lot. All the way back to the days of Anthony Salvaggio. I don't know if you still listen to Anthony, but he was one of my first early supporters. And I appreciate that, Anthony. All of you. I appreciate all of you. The fact that you would spend time listening to me say and talk about this stuff is truly gratifying, and it's appreciated. If it wasn't for you guys, there's no point in doing this. I wouldn't want to do it. So you guys have pretty much really carried me through 49 episodes and to the 50th episode mark. So pat yourselves on the back. You've done good work, and couldn't ask for a better audience. So with that said, again, this has been episode 49. Thanks for listening, and keep gaming.
Think now, looking back, we did not fight the enemy. We fought ourselves. And the enemy was in us. The war is over for me now, but it will always be there the rest of my days. As I'm sure Elias will be, fighting with Barnes for what Ra called possession of my soul. There are times since I felt like the child born of those two fathers. But be that as it may, those of us who did make it have an obligation to build again, to teach to others what we know, try with what's left of our lives to find a goodness and meaning to this life.